Welcome to module 11 of point set topology course. We have seen, we have introduced the notion of equivalences amongst metric spaces and topological spaces. Isometry, similarity, and homeomorphism. And you have also seen that isometry implies similarity. Similarity implies homeomorphism. So today we shall discuss the topic of reversing implications here. Does homeomorphism imply similarity? Does similarity imply isometry? The guess is that answer is in the negative, and we will see. So for producing negative answers, you have to produce examples. So this way, the concept of all these isometry, similarity, and homeomorphism may be a little more clearer to us. So that is the idea. How to see that two metric spaces are non-isometric? You know, on one side, producing an isometry may be very difficult, but how to say it is non-isometry? The only general method is to find the so-called isometric invariants such that one of them possesses it, the other one doesn't possess it. Okay, but what we want is similar ones which are not isometric. Two metrics should be similar. So if your invariant is preserved under similarity also, then it will not be no use. So the invariant should be fragile enough so that when you look at similarity, it is not preserved. It is violated. Okay, so such things we have to hunt around. So having said that, there are several ad hoc methods to implement the above idea, depending upon what two spaces you have in front of you. Okay, this method may not work, that method may not work. Something which appeals to you may just try it out, it may work. So that is the kind of approach we have, because you are not, to begin with, you are not given the spaces. So here are two similar spaces. Are they isometric? This is a question. You don't know. So that, for that, you have to understand both the spaces properly. This is one thing which happens here, what happened doesn't here. This is the way you have to go around. Okay, so that is why it is a ad hoc method that you have to quite often do that. In any case, obviously, we are more concentrating on topology, so we will not go deeper into this aspect, okay? That will be taken up by differential geometers, or more surely geometers, combinatory people, and so on. Okay, so we will have only few easy examples. So let us take, for example, okay, being boundedness, which we have seen, that is an isometric invariant. Okay, suppose one metric space with the metric, it is bounded. On the same set, you may have another metric which is not bounded. Then immediately you can say that these two are not isometric. But can they be similar also? Yes, they can be similar also. So that is the whole idea. Okay. So being bounded is an isometry invariant, but it is also a similarity invariant. Okay. So this will not work. Okay. Here is an example, easy way to use, quite useful concept also, which is an isometric invariant, but not a similarity invariant. So I am trying to cook up something like that. Okay. So this is the new concept that we have here, which is very canonical and very geometrical in nature. Take a metric space, take any subset, can be empty also, don't worry about that. The diameter of that subset A is defined as, so I have two notations here, delta A, wherein I have ignored the metric, but if metric has to be mentioned, so there are two different ones, then that has to be mentioned, then I use this notation, delta A colon D. Okay, so this is nothing but, look at all the numbers, distance between x and y, where x and y are arbitrary points of A, then take the suprema. Okay, this supremum may be infinite, I don't care. If A is empty, this will be minus infinity also. Makes sense. Supremum of any set of real numbers, if you include minus infinity plus infinity, it makes sense. Okay. If delta A or delta X is bounded, namely finite, okay, so if number is bounded, so the real number is finite, then we say X is bounded. Okay. Including delta X equal to minus infinity. That will not happen because our metric spaces are usually non-empty. If you take A to be empty, delta A may be minus infinity. Empty set is bounded. That's okay. No problem. So, delta X finite, we say X is bounded. In that case, we also say that the metric itself is bounded. Okay, because I have taken the entire X here. Okay. The metric D may not be bounded, but a subset may be bounded. Like any finite set, you know, is bounded. Okay. So, all these concepts are there in Rn also, in R also. So, it is nothing new as such. So, we were just testing the concept by just looking at the definition. Supremum of D, X, Y, where X and Y range over all points of A. Okay. So I am making this remark here, delta empty is minus infinity, and delta A is zero if and only if A is a singleton. As soon as there are two points, the distance between them we know is positive. So supremum will be positive. Okay, only if A is a singleton, then delta A is zero. Okay. So all these things may not be very useful, but it will make the definition clear. All right. Now look at a isometry from x1 d1 to x2 d2. Okay. Then look at all the real number d1 xy, where x and y range over x1. Now on the other side, D2 of AB, where A and B range over X2. So these two are two sets of real numbers. I want to say there is a bijection between them, induced by this F, F from X1 cross X1 to X2 cross X2. Okay, namely, put A equal to Fx and B equal to Fy. So that will give you for each point D1 xy, FD2 of FX FY, which is equal to even. So the same number will come here. So if you can use the reverse way, F inverse, and you go here. So what happens is this set as totality on this set is equal to totality of this set. Therefore, supremum over this one is same thing as supremum over this one because the sets are the same. But supremum on this one is delta x1 d1, and here it is delta x2 d2. So what we have proved is that under isometry, the diameter is preserved. Okay, diameter is an isometric invariant. Okay. Now we can make this one, we can use this one to show that similarity does not imply isometry. Not just boundedness, but more fragile thing, namely diameter. Let XD be a bounded metric now. Start with a bounded metric so that diameter is finite. That is the definition, right? So put delta of XD equal to M. Okay, I am putting this positive because I don't want to take X as a non-empty, an empty set, that's all. Now define D prime of XY equal to twice D of XY. So this is definition of D prime. Again, on X cross X, okay, for every XY belong to X, we can easily check that this is also a metric. So I am producing another metric by just multiplying by 2. You could have taken any real number here, non-zero, that's all, instead of 2. So this D prime is also a metric. Moreover, look at the identity map that defines similarity now. Okay, all that D prime of X twice, D of XY is less than or equal to D prime of XY, less than or equal to twice DXY. So that is the similarity relation, right? And there is no other function, it's identity function itself. So identity is a similarity between XD and XD prime. But the diameter with respect to D prime will be exactly twice M. Okay. For each number here in the definition of this one, there will be a twice that number in the other one. Here, the other one, right? So there are two sets like this. So the supremum of this one will be twice the supremum of, supremum of this one will be twice supremum of this one. So that is what is D of delta of XD prime here is twice N. Okay, I could have put any number R not equal to 1, not equal to 0, of course. Then also it would have worked. So this was an easy method, you see, easy method to see that. Only thing is, I have assumed bounded metric without which this finite number doesn't make sense. Then even multiplying by infinity goes to infinity, there is no contradiction. So the above cheap method to get non-isometric metric spaces, which are similar to each other, does not work in general, namely when the metric is unbounded. For instance, look at a vector space V, okay, and take any norm on it. For any positive real number R, just like we did it for 2 here, you can take R times the norm, you can take 2 times the norm, alright, by and call it as norm prime. So you have two different metrics here, D and D prime, corresponding metrics. Okay. Then look at the vector space V to V. Okay. Here I put D here I put D prime here. The norm here is the original norm, here it is the norm prime, which is R times the QN norm. Now you take the function mu of X equal to X by R. Okay, all that you need is R must be again as usual, not 0, not equal to 1, then it won't be much of a choice here. Okay, for here I should have taken R not equal to 0, that's all. R equal to 1, it is the same, they are the same. So not equal to 0, not equal to 1 is obvious. Okay, you can define like this, there is no problem. But if you want something more like an isometry when you come here, you have to put that condition. Okay. So this is an isometry. Okay, you have to check that. So norm of x, suppose it's 1 here, in the second norm, norm prime, the same vector would be r times that. But I am taking x by r, so r and r cancels out. So it will be normal. So I am just giving an example, but that's not needed. Just norm of x here will become x by norm x would be equal to that one, because there is an r here in the denominator, r here in the numerator. That's okay. So multiplication by some number may not produce the necessary thing in the case of infinite dimensional vector spaces. Okay, the same thing, you restrict, take the subset V, any finite subset may do, but take something nice, namely all points such as norm of x equal to 1. That's a unit sphere. Okay. And look at the two matrix on this set. I'm taking the first norm here. Okay. So this set, now you take the two different matrix and restrict it to this A. Okay. When you restrict a matrix to a subset, that's another matrix space. That's what we have seen. So then that matrix space is AD. AD prime will not be isometric. Why? Because the diameter of the first one is 1. But the same thing, the diameter of the other one will be R times that. Okay, because you are multiplying by R. Okay. Clearly, if you take dxy equal to, in fact, dxy equal to 1 divided by R times t prime of xy for every xy inside A. Therefore, the two matrix are similar by the very definition. You can write R times dxy equal to d prime of xy or the other way around, because they are given by the norm. Okay. Only when you go to the whole V, it doesn't work, but this works for all nice things, namely bounded things. Now let us come to again our favorite examples, namely Rn and Cn, so k power n. Okay, start with this elementary inequality, which says that if you take mod x1, mod x2, mod xn, okay, take the maximum, take the power p, it is less than or equal to x1p, xnp all added together. Okay, why? Because there are n of them. If maximum is one of them, say xi, one of them, that will be already there here, because all the n of them are there, and the rest of them are all non-negative. So if you add something non-negative, it will be still bigger than. So this is less than good, this one. Okay. But again, if you take maximum of this, okay, repeat it n times, so n times that, that will be definitely bigger than this one. First, you can put this p inside and then go outside also, because maximum, first you take the maximum and then take the power p, or first you take the power and then take the maximum, they are the same. So this is an elementary inequality. Take the pth root, what do you get here? You get the L infinity norm. What do you get here? You get L n times the L infinity norm, sorry, n pth root of n times L infinity norm. In between, what do you get? You get the LP norm. Okay, so therefore you get L infinity is less than or equal to LP, less than or equal to pth root of n times L infinity. Okay, so this shows that, what does it show? This shows that all LPs are similar to L infinity. This is similarity relation. The two norms are trapped, this norm is trapped between the two multiples of this norm, so they are similar to each other. Okay, so all of them are, what are these LPs? 1 less than or equal to infinity. Of course, infinity is already there. Take anything other than that, they are all similar to ln infinity. The similarity is a equivalence relation. So all the LP norms on a finite dimensional vector space Kn, they are all equivalent to each other. Okay. So very simple idea here, namely this inequality of yours. However, we claim that L1 and L2 are non-isometric. This will be our second example of similarity not implying isometric. So this is also important to know that L1 and L2 are not, you know, isometric to each other, but they are similar. Okay. So for this, because they are infinite dimensions, so just we try to use boundedness, it does not seem to work. So we need some other ad hoc method here. Okay. Here is one such. Take the set of 4 points, your coordinate points, plus minus 1, 0, and 0 plus minus 1. Okay. E1, E2, minus E1, minus E2, all the four are taken. Okay. On the XY axis, these are all elements of R2 now. So I am working inside R2 and we show that the L1 norm is not isometric to L2 norm. Okay. What is the L1 distance between any two of them? What is the L1 distance? For L1 distance, you have to take the difference of the two vectors and take the modulus, right? So the modulus will be always, you know, sum of them you have to take. Modulus of this minus, and so on. So it will be always equal to 2 between any 2 points here. Okay. So the sum of the distance, whatever, mod of that, is equal to 2. If you draw a picture, it will be like a diamond shaped thing, right? Here. These 2 points here, 2 points here, like that. The distance will be 2, the L1 distance. Okay. Suppose there is an isometry of these 4 points. You look at the image inside, again, R2 inside R2, but with L2 metric. Inside L2 metric, you must get 4 points which are at distance 2 from each other. Right? That's what you want. So such a thing is not possible. Okay. So what I say is, you have 4 points here which are distance equal to 2 from each other. Suppose you have an isometry here, then it follows that FA has 4 points. And the L2 distance between any 2 points of FA should be equal to 2 because it's an isometry. The distance preserving. So this is just false. That is very easy from your school geometry. If you have three distinct points which are equidistant, that's already a what? It is a equilateral triangle, right? Now the fourth point, which is equidistant from them, is only one such, namely the ortho center or in center, all of them are same centers because it's an equilateral triangle. And the center is at a distance much less than, you can compute the distance, I don't care, it's much less than 2, the sides. So you cannot have a fourth point which is at any distance equal to 2 from all the 3 points. All right. All right. So you see, this is just another method. So there are ways of combining various things and so on. So, or this, you can extend this one. One real aspect here is, the same argument you can use to show that L2 is non-isometric to L infinity also. This time, if you take the 4 points, what 4 points you must take? Tell me. 1, 1, 1 minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, and what is that? -1, +1. You take for those 4 points, L infinity distance will be always 2 from A. From even the diagonally also it will be 2. Okay. If there is an isometric to L2 again, you get a contradiction. All right. So there are such examples and so on. Maybe we will stop here. When we get more examples, we'll have that one. So here is a comment. In functional analysis, there is a not so difficult and popular theorem which says that on a finite dimensional vector space, any two norms are similar. In particular, it will follow that all these LP norms on KN are similar. Okay. But what we have done, we have already proved it by taking a little bit trouble, but not too much of trouble, by starting with this inequality, and we have proved these are all similar. Okay. But this theorem says it will not produce all of them, any metric, any norm in a finite dimensional vector space. Okay, it will be equivalent to the Euclidean norm, for example. So they are all equivalent. Okay, so this is an important result. So we shall prove it at an appropriate time in the course. Okay, as an easy consequence of some topological result that we are going to develop. We will not spend time to just to prove that one. Okay, on the way, we will prove that also. All right. So let us stop today for this one. Thank you.